All right, hey everybody. Welcome back to the studio. Woo-hoo-hoo. All right, welcome to the Classical Buffet, where I am going to start stumbling through relearning these 12 pieces that I love playing very much. I'm sort of in between manual labor. So I'm just staying in my work clothes. It'll add to the irony. And, yeah, let's get going here. I'm experimenting with these different camera angles, like. There we go. Oh, that's why it wasn't working. Okay, anyways, we'll fix that later. So, yes, let's get to work. I will go check and see if anybody's checked in on Facebook or YouTube or whatever and has any specific requests. Otherwise, I will just start doing it for you here. I'll pick one myself. Of course, now that I am having to relearn these, I don't really necessarily have them memorized, so we'll pull out the old man specs. Okay. And what I'm going to do first here is I'm going to do the Debussy, the arabesques. So hit me up in the comments if you got any feedback on the audio quality, especially. Hopefully that's sounding good to you. And let's let's get at it. This is Claude Debussy's Arabesque 1 et 2. Thank you. And that is, excuse me, Debussy's De Arabesque, number un et deux. And yeah, good ones to start with. That first one was nearly flawless, saved my little wabi-sabi till the end. Second one had its wabi-sabi at the beginning and many more to follow, which makes it not really a wabi-sabi. But there you go. That other one, yeah, the second one, as far as technique goes, that's, it's a little bit more, it's a little trickier. But yeah, I'm psyched. It's always nice to see how much this stuff remains, at least in your fingers, over the months of not playing it. So let's see. Oh, what else should we do here? Anything goes. It's anything goes ours. Usually I roll a die, and it's like a 12-sided die, and then there's 12 songs in here. And oh, I just opened randomly to Je ne peux dire. Let's do another French song. Why not? Two French titled pieces in a row, written by Frenchmen. The first by Debussy, that one by Satie. Quite a character, from what I hear. That one's called Je ne peux dire, and no one really knows what that means. Obviously, there's the cognate with gymnastics in there, which means naked. And but there was a poem around the same time called Je ne peux dire, so there was in the local gestalt of the hip artists of the day and in that area. So, I don't know. That's, you look it up and there's really no definitive answer what that means. But nonetheless, it's a famous piece that you've probably heard on many a movie soundtrack called Je ne peux dire.
Okay, somebody's watching on YouTube.
And that's probably my other computer upstairs, huh? No. Let's do let's do the concerto. My fingers this is one where, yeah, you might know the notes, but the mechanics are just, this is one of the technically playing all those 16th notes even sort of challenges here. So let's see what happens. This is the concerto in F by Johann Sebastian Bach.
Thank you.
Bach's Italian Concerto in F. Actually better than I expected. I kind of petered out there at the end at the recapitulation, I guess they would call it, when that theme comes back. Yeah, I mean, the notes were mostly there, but the thing is, like I said, technique to get those 16th notes even, and not only even, but light enough so it doesn't sound like note, but the nice smooth swaths of notes, and that just takes drills and metronomes. I'm gonna do the recap again a little bit slower. Important places I need to work on smoothing out is this contrary motion. Notice how, see how the hands are going farther apart there? It's cool, I can look up on the screen and actually see my hands. Wait, I can look down here and see my hands. You want them even, but you want to be just one steady idea rather than just a bunch of notes. Bach can sound very notey. Another thing about, well, you might have noticed when I did that the first time how I started out at one speed and then I got to an easier place and sort of sped up. That's why we use metronomes. Metronomes don't let you do that. They are annoying, but that's the purpose they serve, is you want to learn something at the even, consistent tempo, smoothly, steadily, and then just click up a notch on the metronome, that is, and then smoothly and steadily there. You hardly even notice that it's quicker. Click up a notch when you're ready, and gradually you'll just keep adding tempo, getting it quicker, and your muscles will still retain that evenness, rather than if you just dive into it and play the easier parts quicker and then slow down for the hardest parts. Your fingers remember unevenness just as well as evenness, so better to train them right the first time. I'm going to do that once more and see if I can not speed up. And something I realized there, I think one of the temptations of speeding up is to kind of cover up your lack of evenness on those, the trickier 16th passages. So, yeah, the faster you're going, then I guess the less room for error, and you can cover your sloppiness a little bit more. Whereas if you really have to take it methodically at that slower speed, you really start to find where those little glitches are in your firing sequences there, but that's the whole point. Find those places, go back, iron them out. Really, sometimes you can spend a whole hour on just one or two measures and doing that proper metronome work. So, yeah, it's the discipline. It's not always the funnest thing, but it sure pays off. I'm not going to do it right now. Part of this buffet will include some of that master class, me just behind the scenes ironing this stuff out, as I call it, ironing out the wrinkles. I'm using that metaphor in both classical piano and in my Shakespeare scenes now. So you find those parts that just need to be addressed more than the others, instead of just like running everything over and over and over in its entirety. You know, do that once, find the little struggle areas, the little wrinkles, note them, spend the bulk of your time in there zooming in, zooming out a little bit, getting a roll into it. Oh, maybe you got to zoom in on that stumbling block and just do that spot work. And then at the end, go through and do another run through, and you might not have everything wrinkled out, but you're probably going to see those wrinkles reined in a little bit, and that's a good feeling. So, let's see if anybody's got some requests. Give me a request. Oh, hey, Marin. Marin, what do you want to hear? We got Chopin. We got Gershwin. We've got, oh, gosh, Beethoven. We've got Hinostera. I might have to go here in a second. I got some more work to do outside. Ooh, Prokofiev. I'm not going to play Toccata today because it is insane. I might play one of the Hinosteras. Don't know if I've got the time or the energy for a Gershwin. Oh, I know. Let's do some ragtime. Let's do Ragtime Nightingale, and that'll probably wrap it up. Thank you. It's Joseph Lamb, the other of the big three of the ragtime composers. That is the ragtime nightingale. Interesting that it is in the minor key. You don't really think of ragtime as being quite often in the minor key, but that one is. That one was written in 1915, so a little bit later in the ragtime period. Scott Joplin having just sort of kind of defined the genre right at the turn of the century there. I'm going to do one more. This is the second movement of Alberto Ginastera's Danzas Argentinas. It's he was Argentina's premier 20th century composer and wrote just wonderful concert hall music in the Western European tradition, but blended with his love for Argentina's national instrument, which of course was the guitar. So instead of always having things in nice thirds, 1, 3, 5, yay, you'd have a lot of these fourths and fifths, because the guitar is tuned in fourths. It goes eat at Dave's, get better eggs, goes a fourth, a fourth, a fourth. There's one third in there, and then a fourth. Eat at Dave's, get better eggs. A lot nicer than Eddie Ate Dynamite. Goodbye, Eddie, is what a student told me once. I thought that was pretty funny. But interesting thing, right before the second movement, there's this quirky first movement that ends like this. It goes... Actually, I'm just going to play the first movement. It's really quick, and you'll hear what I'm talking about with these little fourths and fifths and this guitar sort of essence to it. That last thing there you go, eat it, Dave's get, and then they do the better and eggs together. They do the last he does the last two together so as not to be so obvious, right? E ends on an E, and just like key of C is kind of the home turf for the piano, key of E to me is the home turf for the guitar, and possibly rivaled by the key of A. But anyways, the second movement is one of the most gorgeous pieces I know. So dreamy and soft, but then it just gets so intense, and it has some real intense dissonance that still just is sort of impressionistic, and even though it's dissonant to our ears, it's just still lovely. Some of these constructions, it's just something else. Anyways, this is the second movement of Danzas Argentinas by Alberto Ginastera. This is called Part 2, Danza de la Mosda Donosa. Thank you. one qualifies as hauntingly beautiful. Oh, Marin says, watching me play makes me feel less homesick. Marin, everybody is sort of the Sugar Beats collective niece. She's Megan and Brianna's real niece, but she's all our niece. Isn't that right, Marin? Yeah, we've been there really since the beginning. She says, road trip soon, promise. Yay, okay. Oh, yep, she's got a real job now, so she just can't waltz on down here anytime she likes. But come on down when you can, when it's appropriate. It would be awesome to see you. Or maybe we'll come up there because Jen's daughter goes to school at U of Dub. I almost said U of Dub. Can you say that? U of Dub? I will. Anyways. Check my. I gotta see if anybody's trying to get a hold of me. Okay, just because I'm in a crazy mood, I'm actually gonna do the third piece of that Ginastera Danzas Argentinas. Okay, so that first one was that quirky one that was just kind of like a little wink, wink, nudge, nudge, that to the guitar in a weird way, and then ending with the hey, that's the guitar just strumming the open strings. And then that beautiful piece, that beautiful lyrical piece at the end that's like that ending. That dissonant chime there at the end is amazing, but that sets up the craziness. Now, this is, again, fast and furious. I'm not going to play it super fast. Something I would have to even out and to play, you know, I would have to put some work into this to play it really evenly. But, you know, one of the things is, you know, you see people, you know, Liberace, that thing. You know, the closer you can keep your fingers on this quick stuff, the less room for error there is in the firing of your fingers. So that's something to keep in mind when you're playing this crazy song. I'll play this riff slow. Really weird. The left hand's going. While it's going. Right hand's going. It's like rising fifths with lowering thirds. It's weird. But anyways, this is the third part of Danzas Argentinas by Argentinian composer Alberto Ginastera. This is number 3, Danza del Gaucho Matrero. Hold on to your horses. Thank you. Cantas del Machero, Matrero Gaucho. It means something cowboy. I said, hold on to your horses, and I was kind of, I didn't intentionally make a pun, but a musical pun, but it, that one of the things that you can totally hear in there is him trying to, well, musically illustrate a cowboy, you know, that middle section that comes back at the very end. Total gallop. Or, I don't know, a canter, I don't know. You'd have to ask Jen. She knows what that would sound more like, a gallop or a cantor. Cantor, cantor is a singer, I think. Thanks for hanging. Oh! Jen is here. So, Jen, tell us in the comments, does this sound, I know it's not a trot, but what is this? Is this a gallop or a canter? Anyways, it's neither here nor there. Yay! So, she says, did I do the Hinastera already? That's 13 minutes ago. Did you get to catch some of that, I hope? Yay. Whoa, Marin says she's going to be starting at the UW. Oh, good job. Congratulations. She says, you guys have been in my life since I can remember. I love you guys. Yes. Sugar Beats, 30 years this year, folks. Pretty crazy, huh? Wait. No. 31 years this year. 30 years last year. Wow. Okay. I can't even remember how old I am sometimes. So let me see here if my friend's coming over here yet. We're going to chip some concrete in a little bit here. That's its own sort of music. But as long as nothing is drawing me away, I will keep playing. Okay, what else haven't we hit? Jen, give me a request. She says cantor and trot. Okay, so what have we done today? We started out with arabesques, and then I did Jean de Pedi, and then I think I did the Bach, the Italian concerto, and then Ragtime Nightingale, and then the Hinastera. So we've done 5 out of the 12. And, like I said, I don't know if I've got the Toccata or the Gershwin in me. Oh, I know what we should do. That last one, you could also see that one was the most important one for me to have memorized because it's just too fast to get those cleverly snuck in page turns without faltering. Just can't do it on that one. I actually just went to memory there at the end because I realized I had the momentum and was coming down the home stretch, and better that than stop in the middle of that ending to turn a page. Okay, I'll have to turn a page here probably, but let's see. This is The Maple Leaf Rag by Scott Joplin.
Thank you.
Scott Joplin changed my life. My first exposure to something outside of the classical piano tradition, within the classical traditional lessons I was taking. My teacher, I got a hold of the sheet music to a simplified entertainer. And one day my teacher called me, called my parents, like, and said that very evening, turn on the TV, there was this show about Scott Joplin. And sure enough, I looked it up. There is a made-for-TV movie, I think it's NBC, that came out like in 78 or something about Scott Joplin. And it's awesome. I need to watch the whole thing again. But it was one of those YouTube moments where you realize, like, oh, did that actually happen? And you go and you do a search, and in 5 seconds you can find out that, yes, that actually did happen. And what I always remembered from that movie was when Scott Joplin and a buddy go down to this bar, and it was a dueling pianos thing where they were facing each other, and the champion would sit there and play, and the challenger would come up at the other piano, and this old timer, he would turn over the cup on the loser's piano, and then they would go, and of course the champion would just stay there until Scott Joplin comes up there and starts having at it, and the guys all of a sudden start to get flustered, the champion that is, and then Scott Joplin starts changing keys, and the guy's like, what key are you in? What key are you in? And the old timer comes over and turns his cup over. It's a great, great scene. So look that up. Just look up Scott Joplin TV movie and dueling pianos scene or something like that, and you'll find it. It's pretty awesome. But I'm going to work on this last section here a little bit. Stanley on YouTube, he says Mahler with a question mark. You know, Stanley, I've never played Mahler. Mahler, I associate with orchestral music. I'm going to look up right now. Did Mahler do any piano works? Mahler, I mean, that's a silly question. I should know that, but I haven't heard of it. Okay, Mahler Piano Quartet. Okay, which is, you know, I think that means, let's see, piano with, what would that be? Piano quartet for piano, violin, viola, and cello. I would like to check that out. But I'm going to listen to that here really soon. But that's the only thing that comes up for Mahler. Let's see, Mahler Piano Solo. There's like a reduction for his Fifth Symphony, but here's one called Blumine, says piano solo, so that might be something. But anyways, that's a really, way to keep me on my toes there. I don't know of any, oops, sorry. Am I still on here? Do-do-do, come on. Hold on. Okay. It's just my screen that was messed up. So let me check, make sure my buddy's not waiting for me here to go use the rotohammer. Oh, you know what I haven't played that I should play? If we want something very emotional. One of the best works of all humanity ever in any medium, I would vote as Beethoven's Sonata Number 14, first movement, C sharp minor. We know it as the Moonlight Sonata. Thank you. Yahoo. Yeah, Stanley, that adagiata, I saw that, the piano reduction of that. So, yeah, taking all the orchestral stuff and squeezing it down into piano music. You know, interestingly enough, the Gershwin, the Rhapsody in Blue that we think of as the full orchestral thing, I'm pretty sure Gershwin just wrote that as a piano reduction. And don't quote me, but I think he actually had somebody else orchestrate that for what essentially was a concerto with the piano fronting an orchestra. I need to know more about that. But I think I was surprised to hear once that, yeah, he wrote the piece, wrote the composition as a piano piece, and then kind of had somebody orchestrate it from there. Kind of like Hans Zimmer. I heard once that all he does is just come up with melodies, and that's it. I don't know if that's true either, but, you know, and that's nothing to sneeze at, you know. That's what hooks you. That is what everything else is there supporting, is that that melody that just gets in your head, and you can whistle it. Doesn't matter if it has words. And then the rest of it's window dressing. Some pretty elaborate window dressing when it comes to orchestration and arrangement, but nonetheless, can't put lipstick on a pig, you gotta have that initial melody or else all of the pretty arrangement in the world is just, eh. Anyways, yeah, so I need to know about that, but let's see here, checking in, see if we got my friend coming here yet. He might still be taking a nap. So, gosh, now I'm tempted to play that Gershwin. Okay, why not? We got time. Let me check, double check. Oh, so we're not going to do that tonight. We're going to chop concrete tomorrow. So, all right, let's see what happens. I haven't played any of these pieces for, I don't know, 6 months now. I had them all memorized. We're going to get there again. This is great, though. It's nice to know how much they're under your fingers still, even though you got to peek at your cheat sheets here. But still, it's amazing how fast it comes back. Okay, this is one of my most epic pieces I've ever learned. Big, long story. How I encountered it. I'm not going to go into it right now, but this is one of the pinnacles of the 20th century. Feet firmly planted in classical world and jazz and blues world. Boom. And what do you get? You get George Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue. And it sounds kind of like this, hopefully. Thank you.
Thank you.
There you go. Not bad for, I don't know how long it's been, 6 months. It feels like longer, actually. Can't wait to have that one back committed to memory. Some of those areas I could excuse on page turns. Some of it I can't excuse on page turns. There's always those sections coming up towards the end that I'm like, oh yeah, that part. But gosh, what an amazing, amazing, amazing piece. Unparalleled in my experience. So yeah, George Gershwin. Rhapsody in Blue. Hope you liked it, as stumbly as it was at time. You're going to get to see these things getting back into shape, and I'm so psyched about it. So I think that's enough. I think we did 7, maybe even 8 of the 12 there. I didn't plan on going so long, but sorry, I'm kind of being casual here, and see a weird elbow thing at the bottom there. Anyways, oh, thanks, you guys. Thanks a lot. Appreciate all the support out there. So like and subscribe. Tell all your friends about the Music Compass. So this morning I had a little housekeeping episode just to show off my new, I don't know, what do you call it? Front pages, my little teaser screens. So I got one for this. We call it the Classical Buffet. We're going to have Shakespeare's Delight. If you want to learn something about Shakespeare from square one and have some fun doing it, it doesn't have to be scary. It's really fun, actually. And let's see, China Movie Night, learn some Mandarin, learn some fun little tidbits of Chinese culture over the last 3,000 years. Ha ha ha. Some really cool stuff, especially, I'm calling it China Movie Night, just not because it's only going to be about movies, it's going to be about anything and everything about the Middle Kingdom, but especially China cinema is mind-blowing. If you want to watch some good movies that'll just like make you laugh at all the trite claptrap and that comes out of Hollywood anymore, it's just, Jen and I just shake our heads like, oh, people don't know what they're missing. So good. So we got Shakespeare Delight, China Movie Night, Classical Buffet, and we have Scotty Zelotti Guitar Party, which can be anything with a guitar or not. Sometimes I'll play a song down here more in the pop mode, but I'm not going to do that now. I got to go get something to eat. Thank you so much, everybody, for hanging out and being part of the first edition of the Classical Buffet, the Classical Reboot. As Geddy Lee would say, thank you very kindly. Good night. Ciao, everybody. See you next time.